Good morning, America. It's time for coffee time with Cobra. And today is definitely a hard day. Today is definitely a day I want to be a scoundrel. Or a scruffy-looking nerf herder. It's raining. Very horribly raining and over-cloudy. And not nice. And it is currently 10:30. It literally just turned 10:30. Well, I can't dislocate my shoulder, but yeah, 10:30. So been up now for about 45 minutes. Bless me. And so yeah, it's been raining off and on all night. I woke up about 4 o'clock this morning and could hear the rain. Cracked the window and I could definitely hear the rain. And that immediately made me go right back to sleep. Because that's what the rain does. It makes you, or it makes me. I don't know what it is, I just like the rain. Dogs are going nuts because I'm out here on the back porch. Having a coffee time with you guys. Now, there are some subjects I want to cover today, in today's coffee time. And so what I want to do is, they're small little things, but I'm going to cover them. And to give you guys a heads up as to what's going on. One, yes, I am going back to England. Two, it's a mutual decision because me and my wife are getting a divorce. She's moving on with her life, I'm moving on with mine. She's going right in this path of life, and I'm taking a left or going straight, plain and simple. We have tried for several weeks now, several months, to try and make our marriage work, and it's just not going to work. It's just not working. So like I said, she's moving on with her life, I'm moving on with mine. A big contention for me staying in the US was to be married. Because I'm here on a marriage visa. And well, no marriage, no visa. No visa, can't stay. That's how it works. And so I'm going back home to England, and it's not a forever. I have a lot of intentions of coming back here. I have damn near every intentions of coming back here eventually. Because I love this country, I love America, I love everything that America is. The joys, the freedoms, the highs, the lows, everything. I love the trucks, the cars, and yes, I know England now has trucks and cars, I get that. England got past their whole import ban thing. When I went back to England in 07, I actually saw a 32 Chevy Apache. A 32 Chevy Apache. And then I saw an F-150. And then I saw a Chevy 1500. And I'm like, the hell's going on? And I saw a Mustang, of all things. And I'm not talking a British Mustang, like a British made Mustang. It was an imported Mustang. The steering wheel was on the side that I'm used to it now being on. And I'm like, this is insane. And my brother told me that, England has relaxed its laws on imported vehicles and trucks and stuff like that and whatnot. And apparently they'd cracked down and reformed the insurance companies, because when I was driving back in England, it was costing me, I think it was like £700, £800 for insurance, because I was that young. I was 18, 19, and I was with Churchill Car Insurance, or else. If you're English, you know what that means. And they were charging me £658 and change, and then it went up, it skyrocketed to 900 and something. And it's not because I got a parking ticket or a speeding ticket or got into an accident or anything. They just upped my rates to up them. And I was like, this is ridiculous. You know? And I didn't quit driving because I couldn't afford the petrol or anything. I quit driving because I couldn't afford the frickin' insurance. You know? And then the MOT and the VAT and everything I see. Now, that's another thing. Everyone keeps asking me, how does England afford its it's healthcare and stuff like that. It affords it through things like VAT or value added tax. There are certain taxes that you pay in England without even thinking about it. In England, the price you see is the price you pay. So, as we're here in America, the price you see on it is what that costs, then they add in their state tax. They add in their state tax, and then they add in their sales tax. And in England, the price you see is the price you pay. So if you see a chocolate bar is 55 pence, it's 55 pence. There's no added in taxes or anything. If you see a car that's for sale, and it is, say, I don't know, 5,000, you're paying 5,000 flat. And then you add in your VAT and stuff like that down the line when you do your insurance and your MOT and stuff like that. Now, MOT is motorized tax. That's what helps pay for the roads, the bridges, things like that. VAT is what helps pay for the NHS, Nationalized Health Service, and various other services that you don't see. Also, England has a national lottery. I mean, again, this is something that not a lot of non-British people know, is that England has a national lottery. And that actually helps chip in certain areas where the government doesn't. For example, historical buildings. I think that all schools built prior to 1960, built before 1960, should be marked as historical buildings. Because think about it, a lot of great minds have come from those schools. You know, and yes, I get it. Schools need, you know, educational system needs to be modernized, and I do get that. But at least keep some of the schools original. You know, I've been Google Earthing the area of London where I'm moving back to, and it's completely changed. It has radically, completely changed. Buildings are gone. Businesses are gone. There used to be a block of flats that I lived in called the Wooddean Estate. And if you Google Wooddean Estate, you'll know it's in Peckham. It's in London, South London, South East London. So for you people trying to Google where the hell I'm going to be living, I'm not going to be living in Peckham. I'll be living near Peckham. But and yes, I've heard every Rodney and Delboy joke there is in the books. But it's gone. The entire estate is gone. They started demolishing it back in 07 when I went back there, and now it's just an empty flat ground area with trees growing. Apparently they're going to be building a supermarket where it was, and I'm like, why? Makes no sense. And then they're going to demolish what a supermarket is now and put something else there. They're demolishing the old pie and mash shop that I used to work at, Manzi's. That's been there for damn near 90 years. That business has been there for 90 years. Let me explain that to you. The building itself got bombed in World War II. They rebuilt. Okay? Several times they rebuilt. They kept the business open. During the Millwall riots, if you don't know what Millwall is, Millwall is a football team, not an American football team, a British soccer team, as you Americans call it. But it's a British football team, as we English call it, that was known back in the 70s and 80s and even the 90s for being a bit of a violent gang, i.e. Think Oakland Raiders, circa 80s, for the you Americans. If you were wearing anything Millwall, people assumed automatically that you were a gang. You're in a gang. You're a skinhead, and not talking like a KKK skinhead, but a skinhead that just, you know, wanted to fight, you know. And during one of these riots, that's what they classified as riots, because there's that many people kicking off. The pie and mash shop got set on fire. A lot of businesses got set on fire. And guess what? They rebuilt. But now a development company is coming in, buying up everything, buying up the lands, the buildings, everyone's rights so they can't do or expand or whatever, and forcing businesses to shut down in Peckham High Street. And it is an absolute fucking disgrace. I get it that Peckham is up and coming. I get that. Peckham is growing again. Peckham isn't like the Peckham that it was that I apparently grew up in. Apparently a lot of the gangs are all gone, a lot of the drugs are all gone, and a lot of the illicit things are gone, apparently. Apparently Peckham is now a place where kids can actually grow up and not worry about being stabbed or shot or whatever. Well, I say bollocks. Take a look at half the newspapers, you know. Teen in Peckham stabbed, you know, stuff like that. There is always that worry, you know, for me, especially my daughter. Guys, if you don't know, I have a teenage daughter back in England, and I worry about her safety every fucking day. Well, when I get back there, some of that worries will be relieved, because, you know, I'm there, I can take care of anything that needs to be taken care of. You know, over here, I can only do so much, you know. But back there, I can do a lot more. And I mean a lot more, if you know what I mean. And so yeah. Now, like I said, we're parting mutual and friendly. From my perspective, mutual and friendly. And well, I want to move on to another subject real quick. It is English related, so, you know, kind of a transition. And that is a streaming / gaming house. Now let me explain. During my last Twitch live stream yesterday, I mentioned that I was looking at buying a house in England, and I am. I do want to own some property in England that's mine. It is mine, that I don't have to worry about being kicked out, or for this violation or that violation, or, you know, this, I missed 1 week's worth of rent or whatever, you know. I want to own my own property. And so I have been Googling property. And I found a beautiful house out in Dover, in Kent. And I mean, it is beautiful. The front view is beachfront. It's literally on the beach. So you think, and now in the States, beachfront property means cha-ching, you know. And in a city, property is, you know what I mean? Well, that's reverse in England, because London is growing since we left Brexit. Put it like this, the same house I was looking at buying in Kent, in central London, was going for 2.7 million. Let me explain that again. 2.7 million was the minimum opening bid for the exact same property. But in central, but it was in London. It was actually in the same postcode area that I'm going to be living in. Yeah, needless to say, my exact answer was, "Duh, fuck," you know? Simply because London is a growing city thanks to this whole immigration crackdown thing. The whole Brexit thing, we want to control our own borders, blah, 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 blah. I can already hear the goose steps now. And a very angry man with a horrible facial hair. Oh wait, that's already our current Prime Minister. Anyway, best thing is, the house in question, it's on the beach, so, you know, lots of clean air, everything else. So it's this thing, I've been living out in the country here for 14 years, okay? The air out here is so goddamn clean and pure. You have no idea, I love it out here. But again, the house I was looking at was a 7-bedroom home. Now you're thinking, why does a single guy need 7 bedrooms? Let me explain. I'm looking at starting not an esports team, so I'm not looking at doing like League of Legends or StarCraft or any of that stupid shit, and it all just being Koreans. No. I'm thinking about doing a streaming house where I take specific streamers who do stream specific games and have them just live in the house with me. They've got their own room, their own setup, their own rigs, their own everything, and we just live our lives in there. We all chip in, you know, for rent, well, in this case, mortgage payment, utilities, food, you know, and go from there. That's my idea, is I want to do a streaming house where we stream on all various platforms, Hitbox, YouTube, YouTube, Hitbox, and Twitch, you know, the three major platforms. And, yeah, just go from there. The house is a 7-bedroom home. It's beautiful. It even has a 2- or 3-bedroom guest house attached to it. It's basically two houses in one. It's gorgeous. It's £450,000 though. It's pretty fucking expensive. And it is something that I'm contemplating about buying. I know some of my friends on in the YouTube world, as well as my friends list on Skype and whatnot, they just recently bought property. For example, Fly Daily. He just bought, he's in the process of buying a home. And my friend David, DDG, he just bought a home. Now, David just bought a home because he's about to be a father. He's expected to be a father. Congratulations, David. Totally happy for you, brother. Totally happy for you. And Fly just bought a home because, well, it's about time he bought some goddamn property and grew up a little bit. Love you, Flip. Love you, Fly. You're awesome, mate. And, speaking of new friends, guys, there is a YouTuber. She does, her channel, she's got a goal of getting to 1,000 followers on YouTube. And I wish her all the best. Her name is Spastic Squirrel. Yes, that is her name. I will post a link to her YouTube channel down below. Please go follow her. She's trying to find her niche role on YouTube, because on YouTube you gotta have a niche or you're just gonna get lost in the crowd. Okay, my niche here on YouTube is Mondays, Wednesdays, excuse me, and Fridays. I will be doing this Coffee Time with Cobra. Even when I go back to England, I still will be doing these Coffee Times with Cobra. Now, the reason why I'll be doing those, why I do those, is because I'm not looking to get into the vlogging channels. Casey Neistat has that down. Sky William Johnson has it not now down. PewDiePie has it knocked down. You know, I can't compete against those giants. Okay, I'm not even David. I'm the shadow of David. You know, ooh, that could be a really cool name for a startup in Star Wars, the Shadow of David. You know, or something like that. Anyway, all I am is just me. I do my vlogs, I do my Twitch, stuff like that. Yes, once I get set back up with a job and a decent income where I can buy computer parts sporadically, like a processor here, motherboard there, some RAM here, hard drive there, etc., etc., I will be back on Twitch. It may take me, you know, 3-4 months, but I will be back on Twitch. Okay, guys, I will be back. Okay, trust me on this. I will be back. Okay, I will be back. I'll also be shopping around for a decent ISP, because again, once you go fiber, it just literally, and I mean literally, corrupts you. Okay. It does, it corrupts you. Rain's starting to come back and it's starting to come down heavy now. I can feel it in the air. My knee is acting up. But I'm looking at probably doing a Twitch house. If you want to know more about that, guys, follow me on Twitch and Twitter and Instagram and all the other social medias. Again, links will be in the video description down below. But yeah, I'm trying to figure out the analytics of getting it to work, of getting this to actually work, to get this to work. A lot of my family live up in the north of England now. They left London. My mother, my grandmother, who's now a great-great-grandmother, by the way. Congratulations, Charlotte. My nieces, my nephews, my sister, they all left London. All I've got left is two sisters, myself, that would be in London. Everyone else in my family left London or are dead. My Uncle Peter passed away, you know, and it is a shame. It is a shame. But it is what it is, you know, guys. Yeah. The world keeps turning, no matter what. The world keeps turning. And it's called in Citrical Four. Oh, that's another thing, college. I'm actually thinking about going back to school to better myself. Yes, I am a very incredible, articulate, intelligent man. I really am. But I had to drop out of school when I was 15. When my father died at the age of, when I was 10 to just turning 11, my father died. He passed away. and this video is going to skip because it's about to hit the 20 minute mark, so I'll wait. There we go, it skipped onto another recording. It stops every 20 minutes. I don't know why. I've got to figure that out with this camera. Anyway, my father passed away when I was 10. My grandmother came out of retirement to take up three jobs to make up for the lack of income that my dad brought in. And I saw my nan struggle, and I was like, I can't do this. So I quit. I fucked off my GCSEs, I fucked off my A-levels, my O-levels. I just fucked them off, got a job working at a landscape gardener, where I would work, get up at 4 in the morning, and not come home till 9 o'clock at night. All hard manual labor, while still doing other things like, you know, my cadet stuff, things like that. And I was like, I can't do this. I can't do this, this is killing me. So something had to go, and so I dropped out. I dropped the landscaping job, and I got a job working at Manzi's Pie and Mash Shop. Guys, if you're ever in England, if you're ever in South London, go to Manzi's Pie and Eel House. Okay, it's in Peckham Rye. Okay, you can get a 63 bus, you can get a 36, you can get any bloody bus that goes south of the river. Okay, and go to Manzi's Pie and Eel House. There's two. There's one on Tower Bridge, and there's one in Camberwell, one in Peckham. Go to the Peckham one. That's the one I worked at, okay? The owner of the place is named Graham. He's as tall as Jeremy Clarkson. He's as witty as Jeremy Clarkson, but he's as big as the actor who played Herman Munster. Trust me, he's a big dude. He's like 7'7", but he's like not skinny tall. You know, he's like tall. His name's Graham. I think he's retired, or he's retiring here soon. Good guy. Gave me a job on the spot when I asked for it. Thank you, Graham, for that. And yeah, I worked. I got up at 6 o'clock in the morning. Got there, and I was done at 2 o'clock in the afternoon. And all I made was pies, mash, liquor, jellied eels. I learned to carve meat properly from the bone. I learned to you know, I learned a lot of trade skills working there. Guys, don't be afraid to do manual labor jobs. Yeah, it sucks. Yeah, it's horrible, but it makes you a better person in here and in here. Okay? I've got calluses all over my hand. You can see them right there, right across my knuckles. That's from all the hard fucking graft I've done my entire life. My entire life has been nothing but hard graft. Okay? Don't be afraid of hard graft. Okay, boys, don't be afraid of hard graft, it makes you a man. Girls, don't be afraid of hard graft. Okay, trust me. Don't look for a sugar daddy, they don't exist. Alright, just don't. Work hard, and you get hard, you become hard. Alright? I tell my daughter every other day, you know, she's 14 going on 15, I told her if her grades drop, I'm taking away her phone. I'm taking away her internet privileges. I'm taking away everything. She's like, Dad. I'm like, I don't care. I want my daughter to be as intelligent. My daughter Molly is incredibly intelligent. And I mean incredibly intelligent. She was always advanced in some of her classes. She always knew more than some of her teachers. She's in the process of currently finishing off Italian, Spanish. And I believe at one point she said she wanted to start learning German. Language. And you know what? I love my daughter. I want her to grow. I want her to be intelligent. I want her to be articulate. I don't want her to be this freaking Kardashian following freaking Paris Hilton. Oh, that's hot. Let me take a selfie. No. Just no. 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 That lessens you. That lessens you. Do you understand that, guys? That's lessers you. Stop being a sheep, because a wolf like me will fucking devour you. Anyway, back on track. The streaming house, it's a nice little 7-bedroom home I'm looking at. Unfortunately, the only way I'm gonna get that sort of money together is if I can get a big streamer and a few others to help me out. Not by donating money to me or anything, but like doing co-streams and things like that, and maybe panhandling the viewers for like £1, £2, £3.50, you know, and just let it slowly build up you know? And you know, maybe do that. Also, I'll get to see some long-time friends like you, Reggie. I'll get to see you again, Reggie. You too, Kenny. Love you, Ken. Dude, you have no idea how much that talk we had the other night. You have no idea how much it lifted my spirits, brother. Thank you. You know, I'll also be able to do some vlogs from some of my hobbies that I like to do. But anyway, the schooling. I'm either going back to finish off my bachelor's and get my master's degree and become a master mechanic, or I might go into gunsmithing. Now, most people think, England, you can't own a gun in England. Yes, you can own a firearm in England. Just fucking Google, okay? The caliber cannot be anything larger than a 22, 250, or 22 LR, long range. So no 9mm, no freaking 50 cal, no freaking 5.56 or 223 or 303 or 308. You know, you can't have any of those, or 30, or you can't have any of those calibers, only a 22. And it can't be a fully automatic, it can only be a semi-automatic. But you can have a rifle, you can have a pistol, you can have whatever the hell you freaking want, okay? Just can't be bigger than a 22. And yes, you have to have a specific gun safe that's approved by the British police. Not the government, the police. And you have to have a home inspection, i.e. the police have to come in, inspect your home, and find it to their specific liking, i.e. security wires, things like that, to make sure no one's going to come in and just nick all your guns, okay? There's even gun clubs in England. You can just go join a gun club, pay the fees, rent one of their guns, and just shoot the bejesus out of it. Okay, you can own firearms in England. I'm sick and tired of this crap, this misunderstanding that the rest of the world has, that is if England doesn't have any fucking firearms. Yes, we do, okay? England has the number one and most deadliest special forces in the fucking world. Get that through your fucking head. Delta Force, yeah. Guess who trains them?
Navy SEALs.
Guess who trains them?
IGIN.
Guess who trains them? That's right. The SAS. Every special forces around the world owes the SAS. Fuck. The Army Rangers was originally going to be part of the whole Green Beret fucking Rambo Special Forces whatever, and they own their literal beginnings to the British SAS from World War II. Yeah, the whole Rangers lead the way. Thank the SAS, thank the British. So the coffee's done, which means this vlog's almost done. Anyway, guys, it's been going on for 28 minutes and change. So, anyway, Streaming House, talked about me going back to England, talked about, jobs, yes. When I get back to England, I'm either, like I said, even going to go to college and, just try and get my four-year degree down faster and then refile for a K-1 visa and everything else and whatnot and come back and live the American dream and be happy. Or I am going to go to night school, which means it's going to take longer, and get me a job. And, you know, ultimately my end goal is to be back here in the States, but not necessarily the state of Utah. I never say never, guys. That's where I'm going to leave it. Okay? I'm going to leave it there with a never say never, okay? And I'm going to end this vlog with a stay safe, have fun. And I'll see you in the next coffee time. Peace.